Okay. Aboriginal Australians were probably rainmakers. Yeah. Aboriginal Australians were probably rainmakers. Uluru, or Ayers Rock, as it used to be called in Australia, may have been a rain scraper. A rain scraper. Throughout contemporary and ancient history, mankind has had a remarkably ignorant relationship with precipitation. Yeah. There. Precipitation relationship was almost non-existent. Yeah. Oh, it's gonna rain today. Or, hey, we got a drought. What we admire as progressive initiative in research and engineering may only in fact be little more than an insignificant fraction in the possibility of human reason and other higher forms of thought any human individual might be capable of. The ancient Aboriginals marched to a different tune, as it were, and came up with stewardship fire setting in order to do what we now might tend to think of as preventative burns of the bush or scrub or woodland. To keep later more life-threatening bushfires from happening. As they call the United States wildfires. Oh, you mean they have tame ones? Freddy Flame, get Freddy Flame back in the pan now. It's time for him to go home.
Well, Freddy, how do you like the, you know, tame fire?
Well, flame and fortune. Yeah, okay. Wildfires, anyway. But, you know, so the Aborigines marched to a different tune. You know, they were doing, you know. Okay, they came up with stewardship fire setting in order to do what we might tend to think of as preventative burns of the bush or scrub or woodland. But were they doing more? We don't know. And worse, have refused to know about the concept of cloud seeding, as it was called in the 1950s. You see, when someone has proffered the illusion of being learned. Hi, buddy. That person or group of them, even worse, will actually stand in the way of discovery until they happen upon some actual research they can steal safely. The Aboriginal scientists lacked what so-called civilization had, and that was a form of literature capability that used characters on a portable sheaf of any sorts, such as paper. that when in conjunction with a learned mind could act as a sort of tape recorder to reproduce words, much as you're doing now, or I'm doing now when I read, catchy word, read this text I have set down. We imagine this to be a great thing, but it is trivial compared to what else we might have come up with by now. Stop thinking so highly of yourself, and maybe you'll get somewhere for a change. Maybe you'll start making historic landmark strides and be hated by everyone. Hemlock cocktails extended to you from everywhere in the bristling crowd. You know, it's what they did to Socrates when he began to get through. A small bunch of guys, they realized he was teaching for free. So they executed him. They made him drink hemlock. So what do you think all this artwork is about that I've been trying to show you on my website? I don't know if you've ever gone and checked out my art. That's http://www.paulhallart.com. Well, it's a non-literature communication that is beyond reading. Beyond. I guess I can't say beyond. I forgot the Y in there. You know, it's like beyond. Why? Oh, beyond. Literature has its drawbacks. For one thing, truly significant bits of literature can be lost in a sea of non sequitur mediocrity that, for want of a better term, must be relegated to the levels of bovine scatology. The Aboriginal rainmaker, on the other hand, if existent, would have passed on the information by word of mouth. See, that's what I'm resorting to now, huh? Yeah. Hey, welcome to the campfire, buddy. Word of mouth time. Might be able to make some progress for a change. Let's see. So, word of mouth, which would then have been sorted out in the minds of thousands of individuals as to priority, and then passed on at meetings or encounters. Literature, on the other hand, has a tendency of taking a dominant level in the subconscious of the reader, which, if said, oh, there goes the hand. They got these new hand dryers. Everybody's going to go deaf drying their hands. I guess they call that deftiny. So anyway, literature, on the other hand, has a tendency of taking a dominant level in the subconscious of the reader, which, if said literature has been trivial, you know, if, I put the if in there, I didn't say it was, if it has been trivial, it will trivialize that reader's thoughts and tend to dominate his or her or his or their, safer pronoun there, behavior and thinking. That's probably what's going on these days, man. Why the campfire? What's that all about? Interesting, that. Falling asleep in my chair at my digs in Oxford during those winter months, having put about 5 or so shillings, or five ten pence pieces, in the coin box of my little gas meter. You got 15 minutes, I guess it's 5 pence piece. You got 15 minutes for 5 pence in those days. I could reach a threshold of waking or sleeping where I could hear words being pronounced in the noise of the gas flames in the fireplace. As we put it in contemporary American jargon, I blew it off. Though as a boy, I found I could listen to my choice of music in the drone of the inboard engine of the Mark II as it droned up the Ashley River to Charleston, down to South Carolina back in the 50s. Yeah, did she ever do that? You know, you try it sometime. You get a drone, a sound going on, and you can actually play music in your imagination and hear it. Just get a whole band or a symphony or whatever. Okay, have you ever heard of the fire watchers of numerous Bronze Age societies? I guess that was before TV, huh? They would sit all night in the obscurity of the early morning's darkness, watch the brilliance of the flames, often enhancing them with special oils that produce colors. Oh, what do you want? You know, it's the early morning, right? It was oily in the morning. Anyway, or do you recall that plastic chain molecules were discovered not by research, but in a dream? The question is, folks, how primitive are we if we begin to realize that we are the cave people, that we are the Bronze Age simpletons? Then we will grow into the new stature, some kind of new stature, and stop being such asses. Could it be then that these Stone Age individuals actually discovered how to generate appropriate particulate matter to initiate a butterfly effect that causes rain? Obviously something of vital importance to inhabitants of arid regions. And what of the profundity of such a discovery? It might be rather nothing more than astute observation, something often replaced in contemporary scientific endeavor by trial and error. The bush or wildfire, also called the forest fire, may actually be the vehicle whose heat launches the appropriate particulate matter, such as the destructive distillates of certain carboniferous compounds, which form an ionic trail of some sort from the dry area to the wet area of the global weather system. Something that would be a weather system